As you are hearing this, it is December 25th or 26th, depending on which day I put it out, December of 2020. The year is almost over, and welcome to the Black Men's Book Club. Thank you very much for coming, whoever you are, wherever you are, however you may be listening. I appreciate you for coming. Thank you for showing up. So today I have with me Mr. D. How you doing, Mr. D?
Hey, I'm good. At almost the beginning of Kwanzaa.
Almost.
Yeah.
Almost.
We're close.
Yes, we are. So do you celebrate Kwanzaa?
Yes. I used to celebrate Kwanzaa every year. You know, I had a home in Brooklyn, and we had folks coming in from Chicago, D.C., the Carolinas. Some people even came in from Atlanta to celebrate Kwanzaa with us. You know, the one that was most popular, of course, was the celebration, the music, the food. Everybody brought something.
Right.
Everything was appropriate for all ages and all people, you know, but our emphasis was on, you know, our community, our village, you know, and we had a good time too.
See, I'm sorry, I cut you off.
No, I want, that's a good way to end. You know, we had a good time. Everything was fabulous.
Well, we also celebrate Kwanzaa, and because we're not Christian, Kwanzaa is kind of our thing, you know? And okay, well, let me ask you, are you one of the people who celebrate both Christmas and Kwanzaa?
Yeah, I did, because, okay, you know, the family dynamics.
right, and that's the thing. Many people do, and there's nothing wrong with that.
Yeah.
There's nothing wrong with that, because that is also paying homage to your culture.
Yeah.
You know what
yeah.
I mean? That's also paying homage to your culture.
One of the things that I believe Kwanzaa represents, you know, is, and to some extent it's based on a tradition that many kings, many leaders, many babas, many chiefs or chieftains, you know, one way for them to show that they were in the position that they were in, and that they had the welfare of the people, was that they would give these huge feasts, these huge festivals, you see? And you had people coming from a lot of different places, and people eating a lot of different things. And one of the ways to show that, you know, you were hospitable was to have what they like to eat.
Right.
You know, so, you know, we got Muslim people that don't eat pork, right?
Right.
Okay, so no pork.
Right.
You know, we got people that are vegetarians. You know, we have people, you know, that eat meat, don't eat meat. They eat fish, that don't eat fish. You know, they can't stand the taste of it, that are vegetarians, that are fruitarians, and so on and so forth. You know, you had to provide for everybody to have a good time.
Right.
Yeah, and that's what we did at our celebrations.
And that's what Kwanzaa is about. For I wasn't planning on talking about it today, but since it's coming up and you know, why not? Kwanzaa is a alternative celebration for people who maybe don't want to celebrate Christmas, or you want to honor your ancestral traditions. So Kwanzaa was actually developed in 1966 at the University of Long Beach, right?
Yes.
Long Beach State.
Doctor.
Ron. Oh, man. You're getting
Karanga?
I believe so. It's Karanga.
And I believe he's still there.
Yes, he is.
Yeah, I think Angela is there, too. I think.
Is she?
I think, but I'm not sure.
Okay. So, for those of you who are not aware, Kwanzaa is a seven-day celebration that begins the day after Christmas and runs into the new year. And unlike Christmas, where it's driven by consumerism and you're required to go out and buy a whole bunch of gifts for people, Kwanzaa is kind of the opposite, where if you're going to give anything to anybody, it's either supposed to be something educational or something that you've built, something you've made by hand. But the important thing about Kwanzaa is that each day has a different value that it's celebrating. Are you do you know the order of the values?
You better read it so that I don't mess up the order.
I know. You got me with one earlier, so yeah. I wanted to get you one back. Okay. Yeah. So the first day is Umoja, which is unity. And so it's a day that you were supposed to strive to, you're supposed to have unity on your mind. You strive to push unity, teach unity within the community. And all Kwanzaa celebrations are supposed to be community celebrations. The second day is Kajukchalia. Kajukalia. It's self-determination. To define ourselves, our names, and as well to create and speak for ourselves. Day three, Ujima. Collective work and responsibility is the value for that day. To build and maintain our community together and make our brothers and sisters' problems our problems and solve them together. Unjama, day four. Cooperative economics. Oh, cooperative economics. Now, think yes. about the fact that that's one of the values for an entire holiday is to promote cooperative economics, to build and maintain our stores, shops, and other businesses, and to profit from them together. Right?
That's right.
So what's day five? Nia. Purpose. To make our collective vocation the building and developing of our community and to make our collective vocation the building and developing of our community in order to restore our people to their traditional greatness. Day six, Kumba. Creativity. Always do as much as we can to stay, always do as much as we can in the way we can in order to leave our community more beautiful and more beneficial than we inherited it. And last, day seven, Imani, faith, to believe with all our hearts in our people, our parents, our teachers, and our leaders in the and the righteousness and victory of our struggle.
So uncommon. Read the English words in order, from unity, the first to the last.
Unity, self-determination, collective work and responsibility, cooperative economics, purpose, creativity, and faith.
Okay. Now, let's leave it at that. You know, because Swahili is not spoken by all Africans.
It's not.
But I think given that many of our community are English speaking, you know, they can sink their minds into those principles.
Right.
You know, because they understand the English words. The order to me has never really been important because I think they're all important.
Right.
And that's why, you know, the idea is to pick any one of those, you know, and do it. Participate in it, you know, promote it, foster it. It's kind of like a village, you know,
right.
Unity is like a village, create a village, you know, it's family.
And ideally, if you're practicing Kwanzaa properly, you will end the entire celebration with a big community feast.
Which is what we did.
Right.
You know? And we really had a lot of people coming from a lot of different places. Painters, writers, musicians, athletes, celebrities, common folk,
right.
You know, children. You know, we had to set aside a place where, you know, something, you know, the kids just got too sleepy, man. They couldn't hang, you know, we had to set a place aside for them. The mothers, the pregnant mothers, you know, the families, you know, the cooks, the artists, all, you know, the creative people. We had scientists there, you know.
Oh, nice.
Yeah, yeah, you know, and technicians there and engineers there. You know, I mean, it was like we all came together because we had a really big, you know, like three-story house, you know,
right.
Brownstone house, you know.
Right.
And from bottom to the top, and even though it was January, you know, late December, January in New York City,
right.
You know, we had people in the backyard too, you know what
Come
I mean?
On.
And there was never a problem. Everybody came together and they felt that vibe.
I love that.
Yeah.
I love that.
So, I think the point I'm trying to say without getting too far off into it is that, I can't find not one single one of those values that is not important today.
Not one.
Yeah.
Not one. And that's why Kwanzaa, the developing and the spreading of Kwanzaa is so important, because it focuses on specific issues that our community needs to face. And it brings those to light and tells us to celebrate the acknowledging of those issues.
And I hope to prove, as I try to, you know, keep my comments close to Dr. Chancellor Williams. Now, he doesn't say doctor on his book, but I say doctor because he's really taught me so much. And that's what doctors do. They teach you things.
Did you give him a Black Men's Book Club honorary doctorate?
Yeah, I think we need to. Hey, that's a good idea,
I'll take
man.
It.
We,
I'll take it.
You know, it's like having a conversation, you know, and he, somewhere in his book, I've made a note about it, you know, talks about some of those same principles, mm-hmm. you know, and I hope to be able to point that out, if not this session, maybe, you know, next one.
Okay.
You know, I got to find my notes to be able to quote them.
Oh, trust me. I know about the amount of research it takes to put it.
I got to give him props because he wrote that book a long time ago, man. You know, oh, but man. I think he was right on it, you know.
And what he had to go through to write that book. It's, I got stuck in the preface of that book where he was talking about how in South Africa they treated him.
I do remember that.
I got stuck in that. I had to read that three or four times to take it all in.
Yeah.
All right. So that's Kwanzaa.
Okay.
You got a feel-good story?
Well, now that you asked me, I had several. I think I'm just going to mention that I felt very good about seeing something yesterday and also today. It's what's called the conjunction of two planets. One of them is Jupiter and one of them is Saturn. And people all around the world, you know, can see this. So it's not like I'm just saying some stuff. But if, as the sun is setting, you know, you look up in the direction of the sun, if you look at the setting sun, you know, kind of over to the left, which would be the 9 o'clock position, and up, which would be the 10 or 11 o'clock position, you know, up in the evening sky as the sun is setting and the sky is turning blue, you'll see two bright dots. One is a slightly colored and a little bit bigger than the other one. I understand that the bigger one is Jupiter and the smaller one is Saturn. Now, as I was driving here, I was going to like try to look up the distance between here and Jupiter, you know, because but I have heard that the distance between Jupiter and Saturn is somewhere between 600 million miles and a billion miles. You know, I don't know the figure, so I don't want to quote them, but it's like far, 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 far away. But the beauty of it is that, you know, it's a beautiful sight to see. And, you know, for many, it has a lot of significance. Some people would talk about the age of Aquarius, you know, and, you know, friendship and good things are happening. You know, the thing is that they come so close together that they kind of like merge, the light from the two of them merge. And that reminds me of a story that many of you may recall. It had something to do with the baby Jesus, you know, and the quote, Christmas star, unquote. So whether you believe or not, you know, it's an amazing thing to see because they come so close together that they look like they almost become one star. And I'm looking for that. I think that's going to happen tomorrow.
Yes. As we're recording this, this is December 20th. So the event that, just to give you guys a peek behind the curtain, the event that Mr. D is referring to is, it's supposed to be happening on December 21st.
Okay.
The interesting thing about what you're saying is, you know, I don't watch a lot of TikTok videos, but because I'm a TikTok creator, I kind of live in that world.
Yes.
Right. So TikTok has been going crazy over this event that you're talking about because somehow it got translated that through this event, Black people everywhere all over Earth were going to be getting superpowers.
that's amazing.
Yeah,
that's absolutely amazing. First of all, I think we already have them.
Right.
You know, just to be able to survive all of the, you know, stuff, you know, the passage and, you know, life in general and, you know, all this disproportionately affected by and all, you know, I mean,
right.
You know, I mean, let's move on from that point. You know, I think that any celestial event like this that's so clear to see, you know, get your mind off of your own stuff, you know, and it takes you to a different place. You know, yeah. Anybody that can simply see it, you know, it's like I didn't do it. I ain't got nothing to do with it, but it's happening. You know, they tell me it happens every 800 years. Somebody else said it happened every 600 years. I don't know, but it's like hundreds of years before it'll happen again.
Right.
You know what I mean? And that alone, yet the frequency of it, you know, it's a recurring thing. You mm-hmm. see, so it's not by the seconds or the minutes or the hours or the days or the weeks, you know, or the years, not even the centuries. It's like hundreds.
Mm-hmm.
You know,
you'll never get a chance to see it again.
Yeah, that, so it's like basically once in a lifetime thing, and that ought to give you some sort of humbleness and humility about, you know, the importance of you within that span of time.
Right.
See, so I think it's worth watching. And if you don't see it because this broadcast came after it, you will be able to find places to see it. You know, planetariums and. It's being recorded I would think hundreds of millions of people all over the world.
Right.
You know, with their little cell phones and their binoculars and their telescopes. But the astronomical people, you know, the universities and the museums and whatnot, you can go to see it and it'll probably be almost as good as the original.
Yeah. I was thinking, would I want to go up to, planetarium and take a look at that, but no, COVID.
Yeah. go into your own backyard. Go somewhere where there's not too much excessive light. You know, try to get it into a place where it's dark. Like I'm thinking about going out to the beach,
right.
or you know, into the woods. You know, the fact that it's cool enough here, you know, there's not a lot of clouds in the sky, means that you probably can see it pretty good if you don't have a lot of stray light.
I've got some pretty good stargazing spots in the city.
Yes.
Where you can go and drive up on top of some of these hills and just be just away from all the light.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yes.
I've got a couple good spots.
And you know, pray. I mean, you know, meditate, think, look back on stuff, make plans for the future.
I'll tell you, that's probably how I'll be spending my my short time with superpowers, is I'll probably be in my backyard looking at this event through a telescope, because I've got a couple nice ones. Well, I've got a decent kids one,
but I've
got a real nice like pro telescope I like to take out and do some stargazing. So.
Show your kids. I believe my daughter still tells me about when I took her to see Halley's Comet when it passed by.
I seen Halley's Comet.
She remembers going out, and you know, we went out. We were out in New York, and we went out to the beach. You know, the darkest place we could find. Right. You know, and she remembers that to this day.
In fact, that was my. I think when Halley's Comet came out, that's when I got into astrology.
All right.
I think that's what got me into it, is because I you could see it so good, and I could see Halley's Comet and the tail from my front yard in San Pedro.
Yes.
You know, it was amazing to me. And I think that's what did it for me. I was like 9 years old when that passed.
Yeah. It's the kind of thing that you don't forget.
No, you know.
So take your kids out, you know, talk with them, get them interested in something that's going on somewhere else in our solar system. We could talk about that a long time, man.
Right.
You know, it's a good thing, I think. That's my good feel story.
Right on. I got one too. And this is probably going to sound cheap, and it's probably going to sound like cheaters out there in listener land, but my feel-good story is you.
Okay.
It really is because I go through quite a bit, actually, to do all the research and whatnot
you are a researcher, bro.
I try.
I applaud you for that. You're making me step up my game too.
Well, good then. If that's the case, good. No, but I've been getting quite a bit of good feedback regarding the things that we've been putting out and whatnot. And, that's what I do this for. I don't really necessarily do it for feedback. I do it to put the information out there, but to find that people are receiving it well, it's really heartwarming. It's heartwarming. So
then I would ask everyone. Each one of you that hear our voices, go out and tell, what number should I give? 3 or 5 or 7 or 10?
Tell everybody. Everybody.
Particularly folks that you feel can benefit from some of what we're suggesting. You know, we're not thinking that we know everything.
Not at all.
But we're trying to approach these books that have been written by people who have a different point of view or have a different experience, and they got some knowledge, you know, that like their personal experience is their experience. We try to acknowledge that. And, you know, we try to, you know, give you some of what it is that they said. And then we try to add our own conclusions or our own points of view. And, you know, as has been read many times, you know, what the rules of all of this are, you know, we are in a position to, you know, with the bookstore that we're at, you know, right. we got a wall full of books. You know, it's like a treasure chest of books. Some of these books I have in my collection, but there's many that I don't. And so even like with the destruction of black civilization, which I read many, 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 many years ago.
Right.
You know, here I am looking at it again, and I am relearning. You know, it's affirming some things. Now I have the benefit of many, many, many years, and I'm looking at it again, and I think the words are even more meaningful now than before. And, you know, we have some brothers who have, you know, taken time out to study and do research, and it's worth taking a look at it because you don't have to redo their research.
Right.
You see, but you do need to add to it.
And I'm glad you said that. Finish your thought.
You know, in your own personal experience and in the experience of people around you.
Right. Now, when I do the research for these podcasts, like especially today's episode, I'm kind of creating almost a companion podcast for the books, right?
Yes.
Because I'm really, really making the most valiant effort I can to not ruin the material that's in the books. Because I want people to go out and read it, and I don't want you to have heard everything in my podcast, because then what incentive do you have to read the book? However,
right.
Anytime I read these books and I say, oh man, there's a question mark. What is this? There's a question mark.
And he's really good about that too.
It gives me a thread that I can follow, yeah. And I can bring you information. So
not a thread. No, not a thread, bro.
A wormhole that I can fall down. It does. It gives me a wormhole that I can fall down, and I can drag you down with me,
yeah.
Right? And so, in doing so, the book. Okay. I'm going to try and break it down like this. When I was reading the chapter on Egypt in Chancellor's book, right? Destruction of a Black Civilization.
Right.
He kept mentioning the Asians, the Asian invaders, yes. The Asian invaders in the 1600s, is the 15 or the BBC.
Yes.
And I kept saying, who the hell are these Asians? Who the hell are these Asians?
Yes.
So that's the wormhole that I fell down today.
Right.
And so that's why I say I'm kind of making a companion podcast for these books, is because if you've read this book, then you probably have the same questions. So the idea is for me to kind of tie up some of the loose ends that the book may not answer.
Well, maybe I should mention not only the Asians, but who were the Arabs?
Oh.
You know? And not only the Europeans, which we probably know a little bit more about, but who were those Europeans?
Right.
You see? And so we have these other cultures coming into Africa and having, you know, effect on it. I think more often than not, it was deleterious. But, you know, it remains to be seen, because the future is still coming at us, you know?
No, you can pretty much say that they, I mean, if you look at history, if you look at, like, in the past couple episodes, we covered Ethiopia, and now we're going to talk a little bit about Egypt today. And if you just look at the histories of these cultures, and you have read the book or are familiar with the material in the book, you can easily see exactly what he was talking about. you can really easily see exactly what he's talking about, especially when he starts talking about Egypt and how many different people came in and ruled over Egypt and how many times it changed hands through the centuries, not just through the Asians, like you said, who turned out being the Persians. And it's not just the Europeans, like you said, who turn out being the Romans.
Yes.
You know, but just over time, Egypt's been passed not just amongst foreign powers, but within the people who were from there. I mean,
yes. He makes that point. I kind of got the same point too.
There was a lot of infighting and a lot of cattiness that really, if you ask me, led to the entire region just being up for grabs as a power.
Well, I tell you what, I do have some notes on that, and maybe that's a good segue to try to just throw a few points out there. What do you think?
All right. But before we get to that, we get to that, did you have any interesting news related stories that you wanted to, that you think the people should know about?
Always, you know, because I'm spending a lot of time observing and thinking, you know. What comes to mind right now is the whole thing about the COVID thing. Mm-hmm. You know, how so many folks, have so many opinions about them. Personally, I'm waiting. Because I think a larger sample size is better than a smaller sample size. And I don't mean like, 20, 30, 40,000 people. You know, I'm talking about 100, 200, 300, 400, 500,000, a million people. You know, what I do know, and I think this may be important to know, and there was a program on ABC called The Shot, I believe it was called. And they had CEOs from various drug companies and researchers, you know, who were explaining what it was that they had tried to do. And I applaud them for that, but I came away with the idea that it's a synthesized DNA protein sequence, and it's like, I think I know what I'm talking about when I say that. Synthesized meaning it's man-made.
Right.
In other words, it's artificial. Mm-hmm. DNA, of course, many of us think of, that helix thing,
right?
You know, the basic, organic molecule of living, cells, plants, animals, and so forth. The idea that it's a protein, is interesting, and a sequence is that it's been put into a certain order. So if we break it down that way, we're putting something that's artificial man-made into our system. Our body may react to it one way or another. They're telling us that it's fairly safe and that it's fairly effective. We do know about, and this is the news that I'm trying to set up. We do know that viruses do evolve and viruses do mutate because they are living cells.
Right.
Right. And lo and behold, we have news, and I heard about it 3 or 4 days ago, about in Britain, that there is an evolved virus. Now, the question is, does the vaccine that is currently made for a specific protein sequence, is that virus going to be useful for the next one? Does that mean that we're going to have... we're going to have to take different vaccines in order to be able to deal with the different viruses that are coming at us? Does that mean that we got to take a vaccine every, 3 months, 6 months, a year or two or whatever? And personally, I'm not down with that. There's news about blood donations that were given in 2019. Yeah, I think the Red Cross was reporting that they found, guess what?
COVID. Or antibodies.
Antibodies in those blood donations before the vaccine and all the rest of that stuff, which might suggest what, folks?
That COVID was floating around a lot longer than we knew.
And it may, thank you, and it may also indicate that there were people whose bodies were naturally fighting it.
Right.
As far as I'm concerned, I like the natural way better. So I'm going to watch very closely to see, you know, how it all shakes out. It may be a good thing. I'm not going to speak against it. It's going to have to be a personal choice. But there's my news.
I'm glad you talked about that because you remind. I've had the same conversation with my wife about their. The story she heard was that someone received the vaccine and then tested positive after the fact. Oh no! They didn't receive the vaccine, but they received the vaccine and then were told something to the effect of that they could still test positive. And then when they were like, "Well, how can I test positive if I just got vaccinated for it?" And they were like, "Oh no, there's 5 different strains of COVID, and so this gives you immunity against one of the strains." I don't know how true that is, but if that's the case, then what's the point?
I wish I had paid more attention, but I did hear someone, and I think this person was an authority, you know, an expert. I think I heard him say 4,000 different
strains.
Yeah. You know, and,
but that,
and
that makes sense.
I want to caution everyone who hears me say this. I don't know enough about it to be able to speak about it, but it, whether it's 5 or 4,000 or it's just the one, you know, it's like the virus is also changing.
Right.
You see what I mean? And therein lies
a problem.
Changing risk.
I mean, technically, it would make sense for there to be 4,000 different strains of COVID. Mm-hmm. I'm sorry, not COVID, but coronavirus.
Right. Because, right.
Because technically, the common cold is a coronavirus.
Yes.
The flu is a type of coronavirus. SARS was a different type of coronavirus.
Yes.
So there are many different types of coronavirus, but how many different strains of there of this COVID 19, the new one, how many times has that mutated? Right. Is the question. And the other question is, if you get that vaccine, does that make you immune, or are you still asymptomatic?
Questions that need to be thought about and answered if you decide to take it, or if you decide not to take it.
Right.
There's risk with either alternative.
Right.
And you got to weigh those and come up with a solution that's going to help you to lead your life.
Right. I agree. So I got something I want to talk about before we get into one of our larger discussions. There will be two today. And this one is kind of disturbing. It really is kind of disturbing, and we don't know the ramifications of it. And it's gonna whatever the ramifications are, we know it's gonna be bad, and it's gonna be bad for at least 50 years.
And okay.
So, did you hear about this hack?
I did hear about it. I didn't pay too much attention to it, but yeah, I did hear about a hack of government and corporate computer files?
Yes.
Well, tell me about it. Tell us about it.
Okay. So the way they got in was really ingenious. So we'll get to that in a second. But Russia, apparently, for a couple years now, this all started back during Obama. That was the first hack was during Obama.
Okay.
But that was apparently a minor hack compared to what's come since during the Trump administration. And they've gotten into our power grid, which I knew about two or three years ago.
Okay.
They've gotten into major systems.
That sounds vaguely familiar. The power grid one.
Right.
Yeah.
That one came out a while ago. They've gotten into our Department of Energy. And for those of you who don't know what the Department of Energy is out there, those are the people who manage our nuclear weapons.
Right.
Right. And the way they did it now, they infected a system, I believe it was at a solar company, and they infected, they went through a back door and used, because that solar company is on the same, like they use the same software as the government systems. So what Russia did was they went through that company, they infected their operating system that was going to go back to the host. And so next time that system updated, everything that was attached to that system got infected, including many government systems and at least 425 of the Fortune 500 companies. All exposed.
Okay. So their computer records were hacked or changed or deleted or
you're talking
manipulated
about,
or what?
You're talking about once they have access to information, they have intellectual properties, they have all kinds of stuff. I mean, we don't know the full extent of what they have, what they did, or what they can do now. Mm-hmm. But we do know that if Russia wanted to, they could just turn off the power.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Okay. Wow.
That's disturbing.
It is.
That's disturbing. And Trump said zero about it.
Well, yeah, that's when I think, I heard some of what you said, but there's something about Barr, who I don't put a lot of faith in, is saying that it sounds more like it's the Russians, and a number of other people saying it's more like the Russians, and I believe Mark Meadows saying they think it's the Russians too, and other people saying they think it's the Russians. But of course, you know, whenever the Russians are, doing something, Trump seems to say they're not. And that's exactly what I heard. Something about he wants to suggest that maybe it was the Chinese, you know, so the Chinese, you know, they do the virus. Now they got the computer hack, you know, it's always the Chinese. But the pattern seems to be that he's always trying to avoid saying anything bad about the Russians, and it kind of makes you wonder why, you know. But, he's becoming less and less of a factor, although he is still has effect, and he's becoming less and less of a factor. I think that, there's shifts being made, you know, but here again, he should be handling something, and he's not. You know, so for all those people who are Trump supporters, you know, what you got to say about that? This is just another thing that he has tried to avoid, and you kind of wonder why, you know?
Well, I know what they'll say. They'll say that there's fine people on both sides.
Yeah, I think you're right about that. You make it funny, man. Make it funny. You know, that's some sorry stuff.
I don't know what to say otherwise. Another interesting thing that I found out about is, did you know that, you know how all this news has been coming out about Trump supposedly gearing up to move to Mar-a-Lago?
I've heard that, yeah.
He can't do it.
Good.
He cannot move to Mar-a-Lago. So as it turns out, when he purchased that land, the residents in the area, they fought against him. They didn't want him to purchase the land.
Oh, I didn't know that.
Yeah, and so when he purchased the land, he was kind of forced to change it into a golf course because I think it was supposed to be something else.
Is it big enough for a golf course?
Mar-a-Lago is a golf course.
Oh, you're talking about Mar-a-Lago?
Yeah, Mar-a-Lago.
Okay. I'm sorry. Because what I'm thinking about is his kids buying some land.
Yeah, somewhere. That's near Mar-a-Lago.
Yeah.
It's near Mar-a-Lago. So that was the idea. That's what it looked like. The move was that he was gearing up to make that his fortress for after he left the presidency. But when he changed it into a golf course, when it was converted, that was part of the stipulations, was that you cannot live here and you can't even be here for longer than 3 weeks at a time.
And, I like that.
Right. And so now that you know, it looks like he's gearing up to move there, yeah. People in the residents in the area are like, no.
Yeah. All they need to do is talk to the people in New York, man. You know, we know. We've known for a long time.
We ain't going to talk to them damn Yankees.
Yeah. You know, I have heard about concern from the various intelligence agencies, you know, about his lack of being on board with the program. You know, I think they there are security concerns.
He says he's not leaving.
Yeah. Well, he says a lot of things. I don't think that's going to work out.
I want him to stay. I want the optics of him being drug out of there. I want the optics.
I've heard the Secret Service says, oh, no, you know, on such and such a date, you're going to vacate the premises, period. Right. You know, and I think that's the first authority that's going to deal with him. But I think there's other, there's like little murmurings of other agencies, you know, in case it gets out of hand. Can you imagine the optics of that? You know, people still talk about, well, he got 70 million or 71 million. What's the latest number now? You know,
it doesn't matter. A loss, L is the only thing that matters.
You know, and somehow, you know, they, you know, that's supposed to mean something. Well, you know, 75 million means that much more. 76 million means it the same thing, but that much more.
As it turns out, that more means more, right?
Yeah, it's
amazing.
And so, you know, like, bite the bullet and, you know, shut up and, you know, deal with it for the next time around.
And
you know?
Remember, that's your president.
Yeah.
Like you've been saying for the past 4 years.
Oh, God. You know, and maybe we should say to our folks that, you know, are paying attention to some of what we're saying, you know, and finding it interesting, that we need to have like, you know, 400 electoral votes. If that system is still in place, we need to have like 150 million people, you know, voting, you know, not Trump. You know, if it turns out to be Biden or somebody else, you know, like it needs to be so wide, so loud, so clear, so many people, like the people that didn't vote this time around, they need to vote again. I personally think Biden needs to stay in there because he has to go 8 in order to be able to nullify some of the things that the Trump has done. But the Republican Party in and of itself, you know, is doing some things that are like, what? Just check out the COVID thing, the COVID relief thing. Now, just use that as one example. You know, how, what is it, $600 might be the what you get as opposed to the $1,200 that you got from before. What does $600
that got approved today?
It got approved?
That got approved today. You're going to get $600 more. Aren't you glad that this year has been so bad for you?
Yeah. You know, and yet they still get paid.
They shouldn't.
You know, the same thing with the Affordable Care Act, Health Care Act. You know, they got affordable health care.
Right.
You know, so you get the sense that these people are living in the ivory towers in the Wizard of Oz, you know, you know, the castle somewhere, you know, and they seem to be immune to the everyday common pressures that many other peoples have. It would appear that they just don't care.
They don't.
You know, so they need, like, okay, so this is not the place where we, you know, cut your head off or hang you or, you know, it's like, it's time for you to leave to let somebody else do the job that needs to be done.
Right.
You know, it's that simple.
All right. So moving on. I wanted to have a very brief conversation. I don't want this to last too long. But
okay, brief.
I'm gonna do something that I am not gonna make a habit of on the show, but I feel it's important that I do so right now, because it speaks to a larger conversation. So what I'm gonna do is I'm gonna address somebody who I have an argument with on TikTok.
Oh,
right.
Okay.
So,
an argument. Okay. Discussion.
A discussion. A point. A point of
contention.
Yeah. A point of contention.
How about a dialogue?
Yeah. I don't know.
Conversation.
Yeah. You're trying to make it sound real nice, but man, okay.
Well, what did he? What happened? You know, give us the rundown, bro.
Instead of talking about it, I'm gonna play it. So let's play that video right here.
Okay.
Connected to everybody of my demographic. Y'all might want to pull this up because the shit that I just read go change your entire way of thinking. Okay, remember this name, Melville Herskovitz. Herskovitz studied anthropology at the University of Cincinnati, Chicago, and Columbia University. He then became the understudy of Uri Boaz, who is thought to be the godfather of modern anthropology. See, they always had an idea that the Negroes in the and Africans, because of their same hue and skin complexion, somehow was related to each other. With no real physical evidence, he started publishing books, mainly fiction books, that whose theories made their way into our history. One was titled The Cattle Complex in East Africa. Another was called The Myth of the Negro Past. Before Melville began publishing his work, there was no evidence that we came over here on slave ship. That idea was never thought of because we were already fucking here. He gave birth to the whole Middle Passage idea.
Wow. Wow.
And then, oh wait, it gets
wow.
It gets better. It gets better because after he said that, I then gave him the opportunity to kind of clear it up, because I don't like coming at people's throats, right? So what I did was I sent him a message, and I texted a text message, and I said, "Hey, bro, so are you suggesting that no Africans were stolen from Africa and brought here? What is this going on?" And this was a video that he made in response.
Nothing, big dog. I'm saying it. The Middle Passage never happened. Melville Herskowitz proves it in his fiction writings. He created the notion that slaves were brought over here with the Spaniards. We were already here, bro. Herskowitz is the reason why we are taught what we're taught about our history in America. And I'm going to tell you like I tell anybody else with anything that I teach or try to lead people in the right directions with. If you have anything or any reason to discredit what I'm saying, the information is there. Look the shit up. Look it up. And then come back to me and we can have a discussion. Because I don't like to debate with people who don't do their research. But we can have an educated discussion. His name is Melville Herskowitz. Look him up and look up what he's responsible for.
Yeah, so you see that?
Now,
Melville Herskowitz.
What the? That sounds like a brother to me, huh?
Right.
I'm being very sarcastic.
All right. His name should be like his brother's name is Hakeem Herskowitz.
Oh my goodness. I am speechless. I am. Well, goodness gracious. You know, should we have the guy? So do you have you had any other contact with this brother?
I don't really contact people. I mean, I made my video and I tagged him in it and I kind of left it at that, because I leave it as I take it as an opportunity to be able to prove a point and educate someone.
Well, let me say what you were going to say, because I think I didn't really want to say anything, but I think I do have to say at least one or two things.
Well, what I was going to talk about was more, our book of the month is Destruction of a Black Civilization. So I couldn't really get into challenging this point without going very heavily into another book. So I didn't want to make this a whole episode where I'm doing this two book episode and I'm talking about Ivan Van Sertima versus this and that and whatever. And
can I interject?
Go for it.
Right there, because I like the fact that you, being the researcher that you are, you're already talking about two books.
Right.
And they're both really, really, really heavy.
Yes.
You know what I mean? And they've been around a long time.
Right.
You see, now I do in the back of my mind remember Herskowitz, you know, but this brother is only talking about one book, if I'm understanding what he said in his clip. One book.
And then he says many times that it's a fictional book.
Oh, well, he does. You know, and that's the part that leaves me speechless. You know, I got personal experience that I think I might try to throw at the brother, you know, in an effort to, you know, get him to reconsider or you know, maybe we have a dialogue and a conversation, you know. But right now, I got to say, brother, you're an intelligent young man. Obviously, you are thinking.
Right.
But one of the basic foundations that we and many others, you know, have stood on is that you got to use multiple sources.
Right.
You don't use one source because that puts you on thin ice. And you know, you can fall through on that.
Yes.
You know, and you're saying some things as if it's a certainty. And there are many, many, many other people that are saying something different from what you're saying. So you got yourself out there on the limb. I hope that builds the bridge.
Honestly, when I hear stuff like this, when I hear someone say that the Middle Passage never happened, that sounds to me like Holocaust denial.
Okay, Holocaust denial. I like that. Yeah, middle passage denial.
It's middle passage denial.
You know, dysphoria. It's crazy. Denial.
It's crazy.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Now, is there evidence that Africans crossed the Atlantic far beyond Columbus or far before Columbus? Absolutely, there is.
Yes,
there is. In 1311, King Abu Bakari II left. Who is the younger brother of Mansa Musa? People think that they're the same person. No, it's right. It's the younger brother. He was Mansa Ku, the younger brother. He went on a journey crossing the Atlantic,
yeah.
And he left a couple hundred years after another voyage left that actually he went to go find them, and only I think of that, what, 100 or so ships, only a couple of them returned.
Right.
So he went on the mission to go get the rest of them. Interestingly, the first voyage that he went to go find coincides with the birth of the Olmeci Empire in Mesoamerica, which was the first empire of Mesoamerica, which had a direct influence on the Aztecs, the Mayas, and the Incas.
Boom.
Now, proof of this of that's been given that says that they might be black or that they were black was the fact that they carved up all these very, very black looking huge heads and left them all over the place.
Double boom.
And the Olmec Empire expanded all the way from the south of South America all the way up to what's known today as Mexico.
Triple boom.
If you want to look at it, Olmec-chi is spelled O-L-O-L-M-E-C, and then the G is X-I. If you rearrange those letters, you get Mexico.
Yeah.
You see what I'm saying? Like
quadruple boom.
Like there's evidence of black people in the Americas. Columbus, even though he didn't come to what we know as the Americas, the people that he encountered, he wrote of them being dark-skinned like Africans. You see what I'm saying?
I see what you're saying. I'm still almost speechless, but I'm trying to get words together to say something kind. Let me talk about my own personal experience.
Okay.
You know, later for the books and the research, right, and all the rest of that stuff. You know, I scuba dive. I've scuba dived for a long time. One of the organizations of black scuba divers that I was involved with, you know, put a plaque down for the memories. Okay, you know, and I think you can see in my face, I almost get mad.
Right.
You know, this was no joke. The ship was called the Henrietta Maria. Okay. So, brother man, research that. There's pictures of it, you know. There was a very famous, treasure hunter who was not black.
Mm-hmm.
You know, his name was Mel Fisher, but he found it. But he understood the cultural importance of it. And the members of my Black Scuba Diving Association, the National Association of Black Scuba Divers, is called NABS. Okay, look that one up. You know, we, along with certain other corporate sponsors, were able to take around some of the remains. I don't want to say remains, because that's like bodies, you know, right, the artifacts, you know, And one of the artifacts we mentioned not too long ago, you know, remember when I did this and I said, you know, like, you know,
the little shackles.
Yeah, the little shackles, you know, and it was heartbroken. It was heartbreaking. I stood in front of a large group of people, you know, talking about that, you know, because it basically what it meant is that these monsters, you know, shackled up babies,
right,
who were running around on the ship. You know, that's how they thought about this. And there was there's a bell that says Henrietta Maria on it. You know what I mean? And there's written documentation and record, because I believe it's Portuguese, I believe, you know, kept very good, meticulous records about all this kind of stuff, mm-hmm. you know, and it says, you know, I mean, the people. So bringing that over, you know, the middle, that's one example of one of many ships. I don't know how many in total, but that's an example of one ship that was involved in the Middle Passage.
Right.
So it's kind of hard to refute that kind of documentation. And it comes from many, many, many different sources. Mm-hmm. You see, so I implore this brother to include that and then make another video to reflect some of what we just said and some of the documentation that he may come across.
I agree. And that's the thing. I hope that he's the type of person who can accept new information and then advance his or maybe, you know, look at his opinion and see whether or not it's valid.
You know what? I'm going to say it. Now I'm saying it to the brother. So now I'm getting involved, you know, because I remember a long time ago when I was saying that we got to do research and, you know, we invite comment from people that have a different point of view from us. But we also said that if we make a mistake or if we're misinformed or if we're wrong, we'll be happy to entertain that as well. Right. So I'm telling the brother that since I said it about myself, because if I've said something, you know, that's incorrect, I'll be happy to re-examine it. I'll be happy to review it. I'll be happy to refute it and say that I was wrong and I made a mistake. And that's just the kind of person that I am. And I believe you are that way too.
Absolutely. If I make a mistake, not only am I happy to call myself out on that, but I also use it as a teaching experience, right? So I made this same dude that we're talking about. I made a video responding to his video, right? And okay. In that video, I misspoke.
Oh, you did?
I did. I said something to the effect of, if we were from the Americas, then we would not have been enslaved because we would have been more familiar with the territory.
And hometown advantage.
Would not have been able to be enslaved. We would have had hometown advantage.
That makes a lot of sense to me.
And I said that the natives that were here were not enslaved because it was hard for them to be enslaved. And so people came at me like, hey, no, the natives were enslaved. I agree with everything you said except that. And so yeah. I had to make another video clarifying that. I'm aware that the natives were enslaved. They were enslaved prior to the Christians.
That's what I've heard.
I mean, prior to the Africans.
Right. That's what I've heard.
So what I did was I did some research. Now, have you ever heard of Bartolomé de las Casas?
It does sound familiar. The spelling of the name in my mind, my mind's eye, I think I've seen that name.
Bartolomé de las Casas was a historian and a priest who came over here around the time of the Spanish Inquisition.
Yeah.
And he was unimpressed with the barbaric acts by his countrymen. And so he wrote back to the Vatican and says, hey, it's not a good idea for us to keep enslaving these natives. It's not a good idea for us to keep enslaving them because we're working them to death. They can't really handle the physical nature of the work. So we should solely focus on African slavery.
Yeah. Yeah. That sounds right.
Right. And so starting, and that was in the late 1500s.
Yeah. 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 That sounds right. Yeah.
So I like I said, I took the opportunity. I made a whole nother video correcting myself, saying, okay, I'm aware that I misspoke and that the natives have been enslaved prior. and here's my evidence, and here's Bartolomé de las Casas. So I was wrong, and here's some more information to go on top of that to show you how I was wrong. I'm fine. I'm human. I make mistakes. But I can also use it as an opportunity to learn and teach.
Yeah, and teach.
Right.
So yeah, let's see how this develops.
Right. I'd be interested because for what it's worth, there is evidence that there were black people in the Americas. Outside of the Olmec Shi, have you ever heard of Queen Khalifa?
Yes.
Who California was named after?
Yes.
Do you know the story behind her existence?
No.
Many white historians now believe her to be a myth. Many black historians now say, okay, she might be real. But whether she was real or not, she became famous because of a writer named Garci Rodriguez de Montelu, who in 1510 wrote the third part of a trilogy of books. And I didn't get the other two names, but the part that he wrote was called Las Surges de Espadayana. Sorry, let me say that again. Las Surges de Espadayana. And when he wrote this book, he talked about the island of California. Right. Because in his writing, he believed that California was an island, a massive island that was ruled by a queen named Khalifa, a beautiful woman. But if you read the story, it's like the Amazons. It's like the myth of the Amazons. I don't know if that's where the Amazon myth comes from him, his writing. But the way that they're written about, there was this land protected by griffins. And there's these women warriors, and there's no men around, and Queen Khalifa had these special powers. But the interesting thing about this story, and the reason that I'm going into all this, is because you ever heard of Hernan Cortes?
Yes.
The conquistador / explorer, Spanish. The
mass murderer.
Right. He was so inspired by this by this character, Queen Khalifa, that he came to California looking for her.
Yeah.
Or for her for the tribe that was written about in this book.
Yeah.
So they were written about as being black people all the way on the California West Coast as far back as the 1510s.
Yes.
You know? The Seminole tribe, or if you want to talk about the Seminole wars, some people call those the Gullah Wars.
That's right.
You familiar with that story?
Yeah.
Okay, so for those of you in listener land who aren't familiar with that story, that has to do with the time that Spain allowed Florida to be a safe haven to runaway slaves.
Right.
They went there. They mixed in with the native population that was there. They formed a whole bunch of new tribes that were both native and black. And then they continued to fight against the American government for 120 consecutive years. And it's been written out of history.
Yes.
The Seminole Wars are actually the first step of the Gullah Wars.
Yes.
So there's plenty of evidence to suggest that he might be onto something, but at the same time, you cannot look at the Middle Passage and say that never happened. Two things can be true.
Yeah, I think there's a lot to refute that specific statement, and I believe there's a lot to refute the other piece where he's suggesting that the original people here were blacks. They were Africans. Not Indians. Like, did I catch that right?
But yeah, he's saying that all of the original people here were African.
Yeah, that they were already here is what I think he said.
Yes.
Right?
Yes.
Okay, I'm gonna have to listen to it again to make sure I heard it right, because I'm stunned. I truly am. You know, we're suggesting continued research. And if you find that the research is saying something different, it's kind of like science.
Right.
You know what I mean? The truth goes wherever it goes. You know, it's like we're not in it for, you know, anything other than trying to find the truth as best we can.
Look at several different sources and find the part that they all say that they all have in common. Yeah. And that much you can at least say, okay, that's probably truth.
Yeah. I really think that will produce a lot more knowledge, you know.
And don't put all your faith into something that's fictional.
That's fictional. Fictional, yeah.
All right. So moving on. Let's talk about Egypt. You want to talk about Egypt?
Well, yes. However, I believe that there's one or two comments I'd like to make. Now, I really got a lot of them, so I'm going to try to condense them to one or two things. We might revisit them, you know, next week, because the more I read it, the more I'm seeing, and I haven't put them into a big order, you know. I end up going to the same place that you go to, you know, in terms of Egypt, Ethiopia, Sudan, et cetera, you know, the upper Nile, shall we call it?
Right.
You know, which is like the part of the Nile River that's further south.
Okay. Yeah. You know. So you're talking about Upper Egypt, Lower Egypt, and in terms of how Lower Egypt was actually north and Upper Egypt was actually south.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah. So I believe Chancellor Williams makes a pretty good case. I haven't done, you know, the research beyond, you know, that comment about Egypt. But prior to that, I think he makes a pretty good case about a couple of things. So I think maybe if we go to page 33 in the book and we look down at the sub chapter that's called Theoretical Framework, you know, it says, over the years of studying African history, I stress the word years, a certain prepositions and theories, you know, evolved quite naturally as guiding headlights in the explorations. A few of them are set forth here, some previously stated or implied. And he goes through about 8 or 9. I'm not going to read the entire paragraph, but I'm going to say that, one, that Africa, all Africans, is the native homeland of the blacks. Africa, all Africa, you know, is the native homeland of the blacks. And that the Asiatic peoples who occupied North and Eastern Africa, you know, even though they may have been there for centuries, are no more native to Africa, no more native Africans than the Dutch and the British. Well, you know, I think that's a pretty powerful statement, you know. You know, two, blacks are among the very earliest builders of great civilizations. And he goes on to say, you know, developing writing, science, engineering, medicine, architecture, religion, the fine arts, and he could go on beyond that. He talks about the story of how such an advanced civilization was lost is one of the greatest and most tragic in the history of mankind, you know, and should be the main focus of research, you know, and studies in African history. He talks about Asian imperialism, although rarely ever mentioned, was and still is even more devastating for the African people than that of the Europeans or America. The Arab white superiority complex is not one. Let's see, not one, and I think this is a misspelling. Not one with less than. There's a typo there.
Yeah, it's a typo.
Yeah, okay. Not one with less than that of the European or the Americans. Although their strategy of brotherhood deceives naive blacks. Now that's a heavy one. You know, that's
that one right there. Oh, can you read that one again? Because that one dovetails very perfectly with what we're going to be talking about today.
Okay, well, I'll read it again. It says, Asian imperialism, though rarely ever mentioned, was and still is even more devastating for African people than that of either Europe or America. The Arabs' white superiority complex is not one with less than that of Europe or America, although their strategy of brotherhood deceives naive blacks. So there's something for, you know, people to talk about. But for the sake of brevity, he says that the forces behind the continuous splintering of small groups, even the breaking up of kingdoms and empires, followed by the equally endless migrations, included the steady increased death of the soil and the advance of the deserts and the drying out or drying up of the lakes and the rivers. And that is something that I think might be kind of new to a lot of people. So I do want to try to make a comment about that, because actually he said that in many different ways throughout the rest of, you know, this first part of the book. And I took a tremendous amount of interest in that. But to move on, it says, number six, the strength and greatness of African people can be measured by how, in the face of what at times seemed to be all the forces of hell, they fought through it all. They survived, they rebuilt, etc., etc. You know, and he's talking about they survived and they rebuilt the kingdoms and empires. You know, we're talking about the Middle Passage now. Here we are spread out all over the place. Right. You know what I mean? And yet the culture still survives. And I think that's another thing that I would like to talk about if we have time, but maybe not. It's like the artifacts of cultural significance that are, in fact, African, because I believe he is suggesting that, you know, there are certain things that African people did over the entire continent before the intrusion of the Asians, the Arabs, the Europeans, and so on. Number seven, within the framework of even the smallest surviving states, the basic principles of the traditional African constitution were adhered to and kept alive throughout all of the passing centuries as the fundamental elements of ancient democracy, social, political, and economic systems. And now he's saying that, you know, kind of African democracy existed before, you know, democracy that, you know, we often think of as being Greek, maybe Egyptian, maybe, you know. So it's like before all of that, African peoples had it going on. Then number eight, he says, Africa was the cradle of religious civilization based on the concept of one supreme God, creator of the universe. This belief in one supreme God antedated that of the Jews by several thousand years before Abraham. And he goes on to talk about, the Christian world, the Hebrew world, he talks about Moses, Abraham, Christ, and all of these are rooted in the land of the gods, the land of the spirit, which is, you know, that cradle of civilization that a lot of people consider to be Egypt. And people trace back beyond Egypt to earlier times, up the Nile, towards the source of the Nile. And, you know, they call it Ethiopia and they call it Sudan and, you know, many other names, you know. So there seems to be a civilization that was there way before any of these other influences. And then I think I can leave it there. There's another point that he wants to make, you know, but the idea that I'm trying to suggest here is that Chancellor Williams and others, you know, have suggested that African civilization existed way before the white man, the Asian, the Arab, you know what I mean? And they had it going on in a lot of different ways. And I think that that's very significant because it shows what was lost. I would also like to add, because I got other notes in here too, but I would also like to add that, it seems as though his thesis is that Africa was destroyed not only by those forces, but it was also destroyed by the climate. Now, I've traveled through the Sahara Desert. Mm-hmm. I remember seeing what I saw. You know, that's another personal experience, which was life-changing for me.
Right.
You know, but I've heard in many places, including, you know, National Geographic and a whole lot, you know, they talk about the time when the Sahara Desert, which is bigger than the continental United States.
Right.
Okay. You know, like 3,200 miles from Los Angeles to New York.
Mm-hmm.
Right. You know, that long diagonal.
Right.
You know, 3,200 miles of desert. I was in it. You know what I mean? I remember what I saw, you know, and they're saying that there was a time and there's evidence, geological evidence, that it was not always desert.
It was green.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. You know, so you're like, wow, okay, so Chancellor's on to something. You know what I mean?
I would like to take that a step further, what you just said.
Please do.
Because I got into some trying to figure out how the pyramids were made a while back.
Okay.
And I'm talking about like the pyramids of Giza, right?
Right.
And as it turns out, the pyramids used to be covered with this very, very specific type of limestone, a white limestone that would make those pyramids look like they were shining from miles away.
Right.
And that stone could only be found in what's modern day Israel.
Okay.
So how is it that they were able to get these massive stones from Israel to Egypt and then erect them?
Yes.
The only thing that makes sense, which also dovetails with what you were saying, is that the area used to be green, okay, and there used to be waterways. They would divert rivers to be able to bring boats and whatnot right up to the doorsteps.
I do believe that I saw on one PBS program where they did land scanning,
mm-hmm,
and they found wood underneath the sand, I believe.
Sunken boats?
Yeah, yeah, and it's like in the middle of the desert.
Yeah.
You know, like why are these boats and they're lined up like, you know, they were docked.
Right.
You know, and like, so what, how who's going to bring, you know, boat frames, you know, wood, timber, and all that kind of stuff, you know, so many hundreds of miles through the desert.
And just drop it.
Yeah.
Just, you know, drop it and walk away.
Like, what kind of sense does that make? So, you know, that is something that might support what you're saying.
I believe that's true.
Is what I'm saying, you know. So Chancellor is busy trying to suggest that that the changing of the climates had a destructive effect on the populations of the Africans that live there. And he's, you know, he says it a lot of different ways, and I got it marked up, you know, maybe next week, I guess.
Come on.
You know? But the other thing that I think he suggests is that within the African culture, I'm sorry to say, but, you know, human people being human people, you know, Africans are not all saints. You know, and I believe you're going to be talking about this a little bit. You know, there was a lot of infighting, you know, struggles, king against king or this group against that group. I think Williams makes some suggestions about why that may have occurred, you know, but the fact remains is that both you and I have come away with the sense of there was fighting and bickering and battling and, you know, maybe it was just, you know, greed, you know, groups of people from one place were busy, you know, fighting groups from another place, you know, and between that and the climate changes and famine and the scarcity of the food and, you know, the Arab people, you know, the traders coming in, I think there was a thing about, one group, when they conquered another group, they would take the women and, you know, now the women, they marry the women, or the women become their women, and they, yeah, you know, they become like chattel or slavery or something, you know, they have the babies and all that kind of stuff. You know, they kill the men, and they take the women, you know, and also people that weren't killed became slaves,
right?
Like slave labor became a thing. I do believe I remember when I first read this book that Chancellor said something about, but in Africa, slavery was different from the Europeans and the Americas. You know, it's like you could work your way out of slavery by becoming a member
of the society.
Yeah.
You could marry into the larger society, all kinds of stuff.
Yeah. Yeah. So you know, it wasn't like you were a slave and you weren't a human being.
Right. There was a time limit on it.
Yeah. 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 But once I find that, then I'll mark it and, you know, we'll talk about it.
That's cool.
But there's a number of things in this book and that's just a few of them. There's others for sure. Which seem to suggest that these are the reasons why he feels, you know, black civilization, which was at its highest peak, far in advance of many other civilizations in the planet, you know, began to deteriorate and destroy. And let me just say one more thing, because, again, there's another source. There was a program that I saw on PBS which talked about the original DNA, you know, being traced back to what may be southern East Africa. Oh, well, again, that's kind of like the beginning of the Nile River, you know.
Right.
You know, where the water is flowing north.
Right.
You know, and that DNA has actually, using DNA technology, you know, been traced up into Europe, into the Middle East, what we now call the Middle East, into, you know, past Afghanistan and Iran and all that, you know, into India and China, and then up China through what we call the Bering Strait, which wasn't like it always was, you know, into North America, and then down through the western part of the United States and over to the East Coast, but down through into Central America and into South America.
I think with the gene that you're talking about, if people want to research that, I believe that's called mitochondrial Eve.
Yeah.
I believe that's
I think
that's
you're right.
The name of
I think
mitochondrial
you're right. So there's some research for you to do, you right. know. So I could go on, but I think I'll stop there.
You hit the nail on the head in what you said, because from reading this book and then from doing my own research, it looked like the ancient history of this region, not just Egypt, but this region in general, was just messy. It's just a bunch of messy bitches. And pardon my French, but that's what it really seems like, man. And I have a theory I'm working on. And my theory has to do with Jerusalem. It really feels to me like Jerusalem was a military power of the time. And I say that because of this. Do you remember the last episode when we talked about Emperor Melanic the First?
Yeah.
And he was the supposed king of son of the king of King Solomon.
Yes.
And how he went to go visit his father, and then when he was sent back with 12,000 people in the ark.
Yeah.
And I mentioned that felt like an army to me, right?
Yeah, but you said in the ark?
No, when they were protecting the ark, the
okay,
ark of the
protecting
covenant.
The ark, right.
So I said that 12,000 people, it could also be, you know, conveyed as an army. Well, they came from Palestine, Jerusalem, right? I was doing some research today, but the research that I did for this episode, I was able to find out that the people who invaded the Asians that Chancellor William is talking about when he speaks about people invading and sitting on the throne of Egypt, those Asians are also from Jerusalem. So it's interesting to me that you would have Jerusalem interfering with the throne of both Ethiopia and Egypt at the exact same time.
What was it called, Jerusalem at that time?
No, it wasn't called Jerusalem at that time, but the region existed and there were powers within it. It was Persia.
Right.
So it's just a theory that I'm working on. I think Jerusalem might have been like a military headquarters of the Persian Empire.
Well, even to this day, that whole region, it's like, you know, all, you know, the whole of Asia, you know, the whole of Asia, right. you know, a lot of people think about Russia, you know, and they'll talk about India and they'll talk about Afghanistan, you know, Iraq, Iran, et cetera, et cetera. You know, that, you know, it's like people, mm-hmm. you know, good gobs of people, you know, and people move around and they do stuff, you see. You know, we can go all the way over to the eastern part of it, the southeastern part of it. And now we're talking about China.
Right.
You know, which goes back a long time, too.
Yeah, because at the time that we're talking about, China was one of the other great civilizations.
Yeah.
There was four at the time.
Yeah, these people are moving around, you know, doing stuff. And then at the same time, you had these, you know, these African people in that continent.
Right.
You know, and all of that, you know, which we've just alluded to very briefly. But then you also got the European folks.
Right.
You know, the ones around the Mediterranean, for example. You know, I could see that if you lived around the Mediterranean, man, you know, it was like California. You
right.
know?
Right.
You know,
a mixing pot.
Yeah, you know. You know, the northern coast of Europe, the southern coast of Europe, which is the northern coast of the Mediterranean region.
Right.
And the northern coast of Africa, you know, Morocco, Tunisia, Algeria, all of that, you know. I mean, you know, and then you got all of these people coming from the east, you know, traveling. Now, they didn't have cars and, you know, buses and trains and planes and stuff, you know. So they were on routes, you know. They probably used camels. You know, I hear the Arabians used a lot of horses, you know. Right. But they were traveling, you know. But it all comes together. You know, in the Red Sea, the Mediterranean, yeah. You know, what's the other one? The Black Sea, I think it's called, you know, which is kind of not.
Is it the Caspian north, Sea? That's north.
Yeah, it's north. Yeah. You know, even Constantinople, I believe, it's got two sides.
Turkey.
Turkey. Yeah. So you mentioned Persia. Yeah. So those empires, Turkey, Persia, you know, you know, they were the result of trading between,
right.
You know, all these different people,
right.
You know, and you know, people trade, and they don't have to be thinking about food quite the same way if you, you know, scratching for food,
right.
You know, as a matter of fact, let me say this. Let's see, where can I find this quickly? Because, I think let's see, the Africans were a largely, oh no, that's not what I want to say, but I think I will say that later. But I think the whole idea of without having food, you know, like steady food, people had to become migratory. You know, life was a struggle. You know,
right.
I think we could think that maybe the climate was doing that. You know, in addition to that, there's, you know, one tribe fighting another tribe for the scarce resources that were existing and stuff like that. You know, so food became, you know, difficult to come by. You see, but when you're doing business and you're trading and you know, you're bartering back and forth and, you know, I'll give you this for that and all that kind of stuff. You know, you could see how you could build up accumulation of stuff.
Right.
You know, and then, you know, you give this stuff to this guy and he gives you something else, you know, and then you get that stuff to somebody else that don't have it, you know, and you were able to leverage up, you know, your accumulations,
mm-hmm.
you know, so the mercantile class could become a possibility where lots of trade routes were coming together.
Right.
You see,
which is why control of this region was so important.
Yeah. Yeah. And I think with that extra wealth now, unfortunately, human, you know, kind of get in there and, I'm going to buy this. I'm going to buy this. So I'm going to buy more wood. I'm going to buy more iron. I'm going to buy more steel. Well, not steel, but, you know, copper or whatever that there was. I'm going to buy more weapons.
Right.
You know, basically. And I'm going to go out. I'm going to take it. I'm going to go over there and take it because I got more stuff than you do. I'm going to buy these guys. I'm going to get them food or whatever. And so you come, you know, do what I say or fight for me. You know what I mean? And then when we're finished, then I'll give you this and I'll give you that and blah, blah, blah. So you got excess to be able to parse out to people. You can get them to do stuff. Sounds like the beginning of capitalism, huh?
Right.
Yeah. So, you know, these folks in the Middle East, because of all of this commerce moving back and forth between these three major continents, I mean, it's like more than half the world
right.
had to pass through the Middle East some kind of way, you know. And I think for that reason, as they began to go out, particularly into Africa, because the Africans weren't in that same kind of situation, I think they were able to begin to control them.
I agree.
Yeah,
I agree. And we're going to talk a little bit about that today. So getting into what I wrote, I'm not going to spend a lot of time on this today, but I do want to, I'm going to kind of breeze through this part that I wrote. But I want to start off by asking a question. It's a joke, but it's serious. Are we about to be controlled by Russia? The reason I ask that is because of everything that we've spoken about. It'll kind of be a little bit clearer at the end of all this, though, why I'm saying that. But here's a name that you may not have heard of. And you mentioned earlier that Chancellor has a writing style where you feel like he's almost talking to you. And that's perfect for me because, like we said earlier, that leaves a few threads that I can research. Now, while discussing Egypt, Chancellor Williams always often makes reference to the Asians who invaded Egypt. And I got fixated on who these Asians were that he spoke of. So I did some research and I found six letters. Hyksos. It's pronounced Hyksos. Would you believe it if I told you that a bunch of shepherds just rolled into Egypt and took over?
Maybe.
And then they sat on the throne for nearly 100 years?
Seems implausible, but maybe.
Okay, because it's not true. they weren't shepherds. That was a misconception that lasted for a couple hundred years due to a poor translation. Hyksos was originally thought to mean shepherd rulers, but it actually translates to foreign rulers, and it marks the first time that non-African rulers assumed the throne of Egypt. Once the translation was corrected, for a short time after that, the idea became that the Hyksos were hostile invaders, but this doesn't appear to be true. The things that I found in my research 100% support what Chancellor Williams said, that in 1650 BC, when the Hyksos took power, Egypt wasn't a great military power that people think that they were. They had decent military strategists, but primitive weapons, not greater than the bow and arrow. Historians will write, their historians, who would write of their great victories, considered victories to be shooting arrows at people while they retreated. And it was the Hyksos that provided them with the weapons and weapons upgrades like chariots. Now, I wrote a note right here because I found this to be an interesting idea, to say the least. I found this in a few places, that these Egyptians were not a great military power, but I have reason to doubt this, although I need more time to really like dig into it and look at it deeper. The reason that I have reason to doubt this is because this is the time period. At this time period, there's four great empires on Earth: China, Rome, Persia, and Ethiopia, which Egypt was a part of. It's also strange that Ethiopia would be a military power, and Nubia would also be a military power, which are north and south of Egypt, but Egypt would not. It also seems as if some of the things that I read were going out of their way to tell how much the Hyksos did for the Egyptians. It doesn't seem to jive well with my understanding of the region, especially considering how the Hyksos were defeated. They lost to the kingdom of Kush. I'm sorry, the kingdom of Kush, who was Egypt's southern neighbor. Egypt knew the Kush kingdom as Tasete, which translates to land of the bow. And their bow skills are documented in the historical record as far back as 2600 BC. So have you ever heard anything about that at least for a time that Egypt was not the great military powers that they claim to be?
Yes. Yes. Yeah.
I take so many issues with just the thought of that, because I mean, there's no way to obviously go back and tell whether or not they were what they claim to be, but it just doesn't make sense to me that Ethiopia would be as powerful as it is at the time, and Egypt would be part of Ethiopia and not be powerful.
Mm-hmm.
That one falls apart on me. So what's believed though now is what's believed is that the Hyksos, what they did was more of a slow invasion, and this makes a lot more sense to me based on what we've been reading, what Chancellor Williams has been saying, right? So basically what these guys did, according to the new theory, is they just made friends with the community. The Hyksos were most likely Palestinian men who had come across the Red Sea to start trade agreements, and they seen how willing the community was to accept them, and so they stayed and blended into the communities. Now, these would have been wealthy landowners like sultans and whatnot, which makes sense why they would get a whole bunch of concubines too. Or did you get to the concubine system part that he was talking about?
I was further before that.
Okay.
You know, trying to establish you know, what was happening in Africa before that occurred, you know, trying to understand what Chancellor's, logic might be. But okay. I do agree with you, because I did get hints of, trade being used to establish relationships. You know, people needed stuff, you know, so when you bring in stuff, you know, everybody wants to, you know, hang with you, you know.
Right.
And I do think that led after, you know, kind of like, you know, the trading post.
Mm-hmm.
You know, you're there, you become a member of the community, people start to depend on you. And there's a couple of things in here that I probably will mention that seem to suggest, you know, that, African folks didn't have the same values. They mm-hmm. had other values.
Right,
yeah.
Right.
Yeah.
And, Yeah, because I'm glad you said that, because what he gets into in the book is he refers to how they set up this concubine system, and then those sons were openly accepted by their fathers, right?
So these are the mulattoes?
The mulattoes. Yeah. They were accepted by their fathers, but then taught. Are raised to not appreciate their mother and their mother's cultures. So we'll get into that.
Yeah.
Because that's actually the next paragraph.
Okay.
I'm jumping ahead. Now, no one blinks an eye as the sons who identify with the father's culture now begin to gain power with the mother's community due to their half-blood. It was the father's culture who embraced them openly and made them feel that their mothers were slaves. And not to be necessarily respected. And here's where we enter something that I call the mulatto paradox. It's the difference between African mulattoes and American mulattoes and how they were treated. In African mulattoes, they were accepted by their fathers and taught to embrace their father's cultural practices. Meanwhile, they were often taught to look down on their mother and her culture because she was often a concubine or in the position of a slave. According to Chancellor Williams, very few time was there the vice versa of this situation where it was where the black woman was not a slave.
I think I do remember some comments about that.
Now we look at the American mulatto, where the American mulatto's child was not accepted by his father. In fact, sex was used by the slave master with the explicit purpose of increasing their flocks, going as far as to create distinctions such as quarteroon and octoroon to remind you of how black, or rather how not white, you were. The only real answer that I have to solve this paradox is the word majority. See, power lies with the majority. And so if you're protecting the majority, like in the case of America, you want to make it an exclusive club that's hard to get into. But in the case of the Africans, where they are the majority, you must breathe into that culture, and it has to normally be done slow. So I'm going to ask you a question, Mr. D. Do you know when Egypt's oldest pyramids were built?
I saw some numbers, going back in dynasties. It would take me a while to, see, because it did come in. It was mentioned in the book. It goes back a ways.
Okay. Well, the earliest mastabas, which are the precursors to the pyramids, were built in 2950 BC, completed in 2950 BC. That's 300 years before the first pyramid, which was built in 2630 BC at Saqqara. Now, this makes me even further suspicious of any source that claims that Egyptians were technologically behind at the time, because this pyramid was built 1300 years before the Hyksos invasion. So you mean to tell me that they could build a pyramid, but they couldn't build a chariot? That doesn't make sense. The point that I'm trying to make here is that the historical record has been manipulated to make it seem that the Asian/Persian influence was greater than it actually was. In ancient Ethiopia, and I do mean the Ethiopia kingdom, which included Egypt and Kush, it was just messy as hell. There was so much infighting that it was easy for a foreign power to just come in and set up shop. And the new generation would have no connection to that of the past or to those monuments. Now, here's where I ask you this question. Have you ever heard of Dr. Ivan Van Sertima?
I have.
Okay. For those of you out there in listener land who have not heard of Dr. Ivan Van Sertima, you probably should by now, because he's the reason that we no longer celebrate Columbus Day. He wrote a few books, but one of the most popular is They Came Before Columbus, where he talks a lot of the stuff that or he talks about a lot of the stuff that we spoke about earlier today with the Black influence on Native American culture. But he is the link between the two parts of our discussions today. He was an amazing researcher and a historian who... You know what? Let me just tell you what he has to say about the Sphinx and the Sphinx's nose. I'll let him say it for himself, because Dr. Ivan Van Sertima claims that he knew the whereabouts of the nose of the Sphinx. So here's that video for you right here. Sorry about my page turn, but here's that video for right here. It's about 4 minutes. So I hope you guys listen to all of it. It's a little bit over 4 minutes, about 4 minutes and 15 seconds, but check out what Dr. Ivan Van Sertima has to say about this.
I need to see sculptures of these people. He says they're not in the big museums. They don't take chances like that in the big museums. You have to go to private collections. And the next day he started to take me to private collections, and I was utterly stunned. You would be surprised how much history is hidden in private museums. They don't allow these things in the big places. It's just like in Egypt. I am responsible for returning to the modern Egyptians the splinters of the Sphinx's nose and chin, which Napoleon's army blew off. A friend of mine, Garland Roberts, an adventurer, he was in England. He went into the British Museum, and he found that they had the splinters of the Sphinx's nose and chin. How he did that, but he's a fella. He's a daredevil. He would risk his life just to prove a point. And I says, you go back there. I'm going to pay your way to Britain. You go back and photograph the damn thing. Pretend you are a messenger boy, whatever it is, get a job there, get the damn thing. And he brought back startling pictures. And I called Sheikh Kanta Diop, the head of the radiocarbon laboratory in Dakar. He's dead now. He was the leading African scientist. And I got in touch with him, and I told him what had happened. And I got in touch with Gamal Abdel Mokhtar, the Arab delegate at UNESCO. Sheikh Anta was at UNESCO too. And I got in touch with, I told Garland Roberts, you know, he has to be on the phone. And we started a conversation with the British Museum. And I started out by saying, sir, we understand and we have hard visual proof that you have the splinters of the Sphinx's nose and chin in your museum. And I have the Arab delegate at UNESCO here and the African delegate, etc. And we'd like to negotiate the return of the splinters of the Sphinx's nose and chin to the Egyptians. Now, okay, okay. Now, Van Sertima, we can't do that. See, most of the things we have in our museums come from all over the world. If we started returning things to this and that country, we'll have no museums. I said, sir, we're not asking you to destroy the museum. This is a specific object. This is a matter of the very gravest importance. I have on the line with me Gamal Abdel Mokhtar, the Arab delegate, Sheikh Anta Diop, the African delegate, myself, Garland Roberts, who has proof that they were the pieces. He photographed them. And he said, well, we will consider it. Do you know? Sheikh Anta spoke. I had a French translator. Sheikh Anta spoke. I spoke. Garland Roberts spoke. Do you know the Arab delegate? We're returning it to the bloody Arabs, you know. He never said a bloody word. Because the Arabs are not Egyptian. Don't make any mistake about that. It's just like we're in this room here. This is America. It would be hard to find a Native American in this room. The world has changed dramatically. There have been half a dozen invasions of Egypt. The Persians, the Greeks, the Syrians, the Persians, the Greeks, the Romans, the Arabs. That is not Egypt. Egypt is no longer Egyptian. They have not a damn thing to do with the building of the pyramids. We now have hard proof, very hard proof, that Egypt was African when the pyramids were built. There is no question about it. This is not guesswork. This is not theory. We found the skeletons in the ancient graves. We found sculptures, which you'll never see when you go to Egypt. They don't put those things on display. But now we have the hard proof.
So, did you guys like hearing Ivan Van Sertima? He got fired up with that one.
Yeah, he's a person, one of many, who I have heard, particularly over the last, I don't know, 20 or 30 years, you know, have been insisting that the treasures that belong to Africans, you know, be returned and, right, and be taken out of the museums wherever they may happen to be, you know,
and
European, know, American, wherever.
And isn't it great that you can go and find your history all you want? You just got to go to a European museum.
Well, you say that, but you're saying it sarcastically.
Right.
So to make the point, I'm saying, no, it's not great because it shouldn't be there. You know, these guys came in and took stuff.
Yeah.
Yeah. They stole stuff. Yeah. See.
So now keep in mind that in the 60s and the 70s, when these guys were writing their books and when they were in their heyday, they were considered crazy. In the 80s, they were brushed off as pseudo-historians. But now, 50 years later, we're finding out that they were correct. That they were correct. There's a reason why Ivan Van Sertima sat before Congress 30 years ago and told them that we need to take Columbus's Day away. And they drug their feet, but it's finally now called Indigenous People's Day.
That's true.
Now, I'm going to kind of tie these two conversations that we've had together, but I'll do that at the end. No, because okay. I just looked at my notes and I just wanted to say something. We've talked about the Hyksos that sat on the throne of Egypt, And yesterday, I mean, not yesterday, last week, we talked about Emperor Melnik and his Jewish influence that when he took over Ethiopia, right?
Right.
I just think it's interesting that those two kingdoms end up teaming up later on to defeat the kingdom of Kush. With, of course, the help of the Romans. But we're going to talk about that in our next episode.
Okay.
Now, I'm just, I wanted to get into that today. Yeah. But Kush is deep. Kush is deep. There's a rich history there. Because the kingdom of Kush is what we would consider like the area that's modern day Sudan.
Right.
And most people don't realize that they have more pyramids and more archaeological sites, historical archaeological sites, than Egypt does.
Well, maybe they don't watch PBS. but going, you know, south on the Nile, which is going up on the Nile to higher elevations, the flow of civilization went from the southern Africa, you know, like southern central Africa, the mouth of the Nile, and it went north.
Right.
You see? And those are the Africans. Those are the black folks.
Well, now this is the part where I'm going to tie our two conversations in together. Because earlier we talked about Native American influence, or Native American culture that was influenced by Africans, right?
Right.
Okay. Is it possible that the Mandinka were the first drug dealers?
Well, you and your, you know, very typical way of throwing some words out there, you know, like drug dealers. Now, how do you define drug dealers?
Stimulants and depressants.
Oh. So, you know, they were smoking marijuana or drinking alcohol, or was it something else?
Marijuana, cocaine, and nicotine.
Well, nicotine suggests maybe tobacco.
Tobacco.
Like, so maybe they were smoking leaves.
Tobacco, hashish, and cocaine were found in mummies that are actually, they're actually called the cocaine mummies. Have I talked about this on the show before?
No.
Okay. So in 1992, Svetlana Belovanova discovered traces of cocaine, hashish, and nicotine. Actually, it started with just nicotine on the one on Ramses II. So what she did was she took a sample of his skin and she tested it, and she got back, it wasn't even her, it was a different person who did this in the 80s, initially tested Ramses' skin and found tobacco, nicotine, traces of nicotine. And they assumed at the time that it was just cross-contamination from somebody who had been smoking in the area, right?
Okay.
So then a decade later, this lady, Svetlana Belovanova, discovered these traces of not only nicotine, but also hashish and cocaine. And it wasn't in just Ramses II, but it was found in several mummies.
Okay.
Which means that there was, I mean, that all of those three materials all came from South America. So how do Egyptian mummies end up with cocaine in their system unless there's some kind of trade between South America and Egypt?
So what are you alluding to?
I'm just saying that we were talking about this earlier, and that there's a, you know, we spoke earlier about Africans possibly crossing the Atlantic prior to Columbus. And this kind of gives a little bit of validity to that.
Yeah, credibility. Yeah. That there was trade. You know, that African folks were navigating the oceans.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Because how else do you have, Egyptian mummies with cocaine in their system? Tony Montana style, baby.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
So that's... That's all I got for today.
Oh.
I was going to go into this long history, but I wanted to actually end by saying that we would just talk about Kush and on the next episode, and I thought that would be a great segue into our goodbyes. But then I messed it up, and I started talking about cocaine mummies.
You know, the history is so so involved, and it's so rich, and it's over such a long period of time. But one thing is interesting, that you know, we read these different books, we explore these different authors, you know, the research that they do, the studies that they read, their own particular opinions and conclusions and so on and so forth, you know, but we kind of come to the same conclusion, you know, that there's, the picture's a lot bigger than what even these researchers knew. You know, I think there's been a big cover up. You know, just as a quick example, I like to talk about, you know, some of the things that were lost, things that are evidence that could not be taken, you know, could not be taken away. You know, things like on page 53, Williams is talking about some of the preconditions for progress. And he talks about people must have famine free, they must become famine free to settle down and end their perpetual roamings from place to place in search of food and water, and that they find suitable territory. You know, that they must develop a sense of, you know, national community, you know, a sense of belonging. They must have, you know, some legal system. They must have an army for defense. You know, they have to have some sort of law and justice, you know, that applies to everybody. And he seems to be the kind of person, you know, that talks about those things. Well, I kind of think that, you know, for example, instead of building big, tall buildings, you know, concrete structures and so forth, because they moved around a lot, I believe he was saying that they would build like kind of like how the Indians in the Americas, you know, had those teepees. They were easy to erect and easy to break down, and they would move from place to place in order to accommodate them as to the food and, you know, the weather and so on. Well, the Africans did the same thing. So they found that huts made more sense than concrete buildings. The sense of permanency was determined by, you know, their external situation. You know, for me, that is something that I think is important, you know, to consider, because I think it explains a lot. Not to take away from, you know, the cocaine thing, or, you know, the Arabs coming in, or the Asians coming in, or, you know, the concubines and, you know, all that kind of stuff. You know, it seems to me that it talks to the systematic values that existed before any of that happened, you see. So when other people came in to those societies that existed, and, you know, they're outlined in various places throughout the book, I'm at a loss to be able to, you know, put my fingers right on the right page and paragraph, because I didn't mark it up enough. But they seem to be like what you're saying, you know, that the Africans were found largely to be peaceful people, and, you know, they were engaged in agriculture and mining and trade and fishing, the arts, you know, various types of manufacturing, pottery, furniture, you know, boats, that they settled in states that were generally highly developed and socially and politically indicative of their advanced civilization, and they were useful for what they were trying to do. You know, that they were ill-prepared for war except against their neighbors. You know, they used, like, spears, bows and arrows and things like that, you know. You know, and in general, they did not have the swift moving armies. It was easy for a small, well-armed, a well, you know, trained and disciplined group of men, being able to come in and then, wipe them out.
Right.
I think that the Asians, as you described, did that. The Arabs did it. The Europeans did it. You know, for me, looking at some of the aspects of African culture, you know, seems to indicate what was put into decline, you know. And I hope by sharing those few things, you know, I can suggest that, you know, the Africans really were a great civilization, appropriate for, you know, their time and their place, you know, and that further study needs to be done, you know, by people who are scholars to be able to dig into it, because some of the things, for example, you as a researcher, you know, you've pointed out some things that were very, very interesting. You know, I can't think of any other way that, quote, drugs, you know, unquote, you know, like they didn't have planes.
No.
You know, I mean, does tobacco typically grow in Africa? You know,
no, but what I found is that they have it's a type of tobacco that grows in Africa that it's only 2% as strong as the tobacco that we know.
So it would sound like these folks figured that out, you know, and they said, oh, yours is better than mine. You
right,
know,
exactly.
And so we'll use yours. And trade. Well, I'll give you this for that, because, you know, the money wasn't really the thing. You know what
well,
I mean?
Well, why does food taste good?
Yeah, you know, it's they got better spice come from one place than another place.
Right.
You know,
right.
You know, and so it's kind of like it gives a sense of humanity to the peoples of those times. You know, they didn't have phones.
Right.
You know what I mean?
Right.
You know, I mean, like when you had to go somewhere, man, you had to go through a lot of stuff to get there. You know,
yeah.
I mean, you know, you had to walk a long way or ride on a camel or a horse or whatever it was, you know, an oxen or whatever, you know, or you had to walk.
Right.
You know, and it took days and weeks and months. You
yeah.
know? So it became shit. Like when you brought something back from somewhere, you know, like, what? Okay, well, yeah, I want some of that. You know, well, what you going to give me for it? You know, trade became a real, because there was value.
And that's why we do some of the things that we do today. Like, hey, when you go someplace, bring me a trinket. Because in the past, when you went someplace and you brought me back a trinket, you were gone for 6 years.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? And it meant something to me that you remembered me in the 6 years that you were gone. As opposed to, oh, you're going to fly over to such and such for 2 days and come on back.
you made me think of something. I remember the word salary comes from the word sal, which is salt. And I believe many have indicated that the Roman soldiers were paid in salt because the value of salt, you know, was that, you know, you're in the heat and you're sweating. You need to have salt in your system.
Mm.
It's a nutrient.
Yeah.
You know? So where do you get the salt from? You know what I mean? You know, so like salt, you just can't get salt from everywhere.
Right.
You know, certain places you can dig it up out the ground and other, you know.
Salt flats.
Yeah. You know, so that's where you went to get the salt.
Right.
See, so there was a value in that because it took time and effort and energy to be able to get something as simple as salt. Now, we buy it, you know, it's imported from Malaysia, you know, pink salt and, you know, the ionized salt and all this other stuff. You know, and we just buy it off the shelf. But, you know, these people didn't have stores like that.
Mm-hmm.
Many, you know, plants, they didn't have refrigerators. They didn't have electricity, you know. So their lives were shaped a certain kind of way in order to accommodate what they found themselves faced with, you know. And I believe that this book does suggest that there was a rise and a fall, you know, there was a decline in the civilization, And those are some of the things that we've attempted to try to, you know, bring out. So I think we come to the same conclusion. We take different roads, but it seems to me that it makes sense nonetheless.
And stop infighting.
Say that again.
Stop infighting. Similar to what we see, the way we see the GOP breaking apart right now because they're all infighting.
Yeah. We could expand on that. Let me think of the Democratic Party, right?
Right.
You know, a three-letter acronym is being given to one person, and you know, these are the progressives, you know, and so they want a certain thing, and they don't think that the moderates are doing anything because they're not doing exactly what they want, you know. Well, you know, it's like, you know, I'm not a gay person, you know, I'm not fighting with gays, and I don't do what they do, and for me, that's not what I do, you know. Right. But I'm not beating them up for what they are doing. I just don't agree with it for myself, you know. So we got to accommodate other people's values, which is what I think you're saying when you say stop the infighting, you know?
Yeah, because it doesn't get you anywhere. And learn from Egypt, or, well, no one's going to learn from Egypt because that happened already and people are still doing the same thing.
Well, no, I think you're onto something there, you know, the lack of humanity, the lack of commonality may be the lesson that the world has to learn. We study Black history and Black culture, and we've gone all the way back, you know, 5,000 years, you know what I mean?
Right.
You know, talking to people that know a little bit more about it than we do, you know, it seems to suggest that, you know, if you continue to do that, then you too will suffer in destruction.
History has lessons.
Yeah.
All right. Well, I want to do something before I go, and I'm throwing this in your lap. I did not ask you to prepare for this, but do you have a Black business, current or startup, that you'd like to shout out?
No, I do not. I am working on it. When I have it, I'm going to let everybody know. But yeah, I'm in the process of working on it quite diligently.
I want to make that a thing that we do every week or so. We recognize a different Black business.
Oh, okay.
So I have one for the week, and
I will say one thing though. I think that our listeners need to write into your contact points.
Oh, absolutely. I'm going to get to that.
Okay. Good.
Yeah, I'm going to get to that. I'm going to get more contact with the listeners. But real quickly, I want to recognize a gentleman who I've known for over a decade now, and his name is Willie Tubbs. Willie is a 25-year retired Marine veteran who the entire time that he was in the service did nothing other than operate heavy equipment. He's what they call a CB, Construction Battalion. And after getting out, I met him at the Southern California College of Construction.
Yeah.
Because he's the person who taught me how to run cranes.
Mm-hmm.
Right? So that school fell apart a couple years after I went there. And he traveled the country just instructing people how to run cranes. And he eventually opened his own business.
Right.
So
good for him.
I want to shout out Cranology Incorporated in Paris, California.
Mm-hmm.
The guy's name is Willie Tubbs. If anybody out there is interested or willing to learn how to run cranes, that's where I'm sending you. Start with that guy because he is an amazing instructor. Amazing, amazing instructor. And I'm not just saying that because I know him. I've met other operators who he's instructed who work in the field, and nobody's ever said anything bad about him. So check him out, Willie Tubbs at Cranology Incorporated. That's your Black business for the day. If we don't support our own businesses, no one else will.
Well, let's support the business that we're in right now.
Oh.
Let's give a shout out for the business that we're in right now, because she is an amazing business person.
Yes.
She happens to be a woman, a Black woman.
Yes.
You know, she's been involved in this location for quite some time, And, you know, we're sitting in a room that's filled with, you know, a lot of books, digging, you know, trying to dig into them.
Right. Right. And I was staring at one while we were talking earlier, and it says The Black Man's Guide to Understanding Black Women. And then right next to that, a much thinner book called The Black Women's Guide to Understanding Black Men. Okay, I'm joking. It's not that much thinner.
But I'll tell you a quick one. I think folks might enjoy this. I hope my daughter doesn't get mad with me. But the grandbaby did something this week that just totally blew me away. My eyes just popped open. You know, she woke up. She's doing all of her morning stuff. You know, she's not like, she doesn't look like just pop up like I do, you know, but she has to, you know, lay on the shoulder. If I'm around, well, you know, she'll grab me, but if not, she'll grab her mom. And then she has to put, you know, the little pacifier in her mouth, the little baba in her mouth, you know. And, you know, I'm one that when she talks with the baba, she calls it in her mouth. You know, it's like, and she does baby talk with the baba in her mouth. And so I say, well, I can't understand you. So she takes the baba out of her mouth, you know. So when she was getting ready to put it back in, I grabbed the baba, right? Mm-hmm. And she said, why? Now check this out. Why you do that?
Mm.
No, I take that back. It was even better than that. She said, why you always do that? Like in near perfect English. And I looked at her and I looked at her mother and I said, well, because you're becoming a big girl now, you know, you go into the potty and you don't need the baba in your mouth. And, you know, you don't need to be wearing those diapers anymore. And, you know, we're going to have you watching Sesame Street and Elmo and all that so you can learn to speak better. I said, but it looked to me like you're speaking pretty good now. You know, like, it was just, how she learned to speak like that?
You know, I don't mean to be disrespectful and compare your granddaughter to a monkey, but that reminds
me. I know what you mean.
That reminds me of the scene from, what is it? Planet of the Apes, the new one, where Caesar finally talks. He's like, no.
Yes,
and all the people are like, whoa.
I remember that scene.
The monkey's, you know, talking.
That's the way we looked. You know, and here's an example of a young child that's just a little bit over 2 years old, a woman, a young female child, you know, and it's teaching me things about, you know, man, woman, you know, a grandpa, granddaughter, you know, male, female, you know, it's absolutely, because I can't approach it like with, you know, talking. I got to approach it with love.
Right.
You see? And understanding, you see what I mean. And so, if this guy wants to write a book about you know, black men and women, I think it all comes from that.
Right.
That's really where I think it's at.
I'm inclined to agree.
You know, it's like, okay, yeah. Sometimes you win, sometimes you win.
Right. So we went off on that little tangent and tangent because we were talking about books.
Yeah, books. That's right.
Books, because we're in a bookstore and it's actually a really cool, quaint place to record. And there's a lot of power in this room. And that's why I choose to record here. And so where are we? Well, we're in Long Beach, California. We're at Shades of Africa. It's located at 1001 4th Street, Long Beach, California. But you know, we're in the age of COVID, so you don't have to stop in. You can shop online. There's plenty of ways to do that. Any book that I talk about, you can buy here, and plenty other titles on shadesofafrica.com. You can also use our promo code. We got a promo code now, and that promo code is, do you know the promo code?
No.
It's uncommon sense. It's uncommon sense. I couldn't forget that because that's me.
Well, has it been fully established yet?
It's there.
Okay.
It's uncommon sense. So if you if you're looking to buy one of these books, you get 10% off. Use that promo code Uncommon Sense. And
what else does it say? What does it look like?
I haven't even been on it.
Okay.
I haven't even been on it.
Okay, but the idea is that you're going to be able to get these books, and again, we want you to be able to read them for yourself and come to your own conclusions about what they say. But we want you to get back to us, and don't forget your handles.
Yes. Yeah. So
I should have some handles soon.
I really, really, really want you guys to, like we said earlier in the show, please tell everybody you know, anybody who you know may be interested in about the show. Give us a review, please, if you can. It would be very helpful. It helps the algorithm to spread the show to more people. So comment, review.
Comment, review.
Subscribe.
Feedback.
Tell your friends.
Yeah, we want to hear from you. Correct us where we have been wrong. Let us know where we've been right. Let us know how this information has affected you and yours. Spread the word so that we can continue this effort.
Yes, and you can send all your corrections, comments, and death threats to me at wellreadblackman@gmail.com. That's wellreadblackman, all one word, @gmail.com. You can also hit me up at Uncommon Sense on TikTok. I'm also at Creating Black Readers on Instagram. And that is our show.
Peace out, everybody. Happy Kwanzaa.
Happy Kwanzaa. Love you. Peace.
Peace.